this Shavua is Parashat the Chodesh, Parashat Tazria. Birth to a male or female, Tazria gives her different days that she sits in purity. For a male is 7 days, a female is 14 days. And then she has Yemei Tahara, which is one long in between purity days. She cannot touch any holy things, cannot enter the temple until she finishes the day of purity, and then she brings a sacrifice. So the Rambam explains that the reason of Tumah and Tahara, of Nida, and the same thing a woman gives birth, is really the word Tum'ah comes from the word Tamya, death. That the opportunity of life is died. So the blood that comes out of a woman is a cleanup. And when she gets clean with all the blood, then she's ready for a new receiving of a new life. So that's the tumah, the death of life. Even here is different. Here she gave birth. And even if she didn't give birth, the child died, the baby in a few months was a miscarriage. But if the baby was born, and now she has a baby, so then it's not a death, it's the opposite, it's really life. Because the baby came out and life came out. But the blood of coming out is a cleanup, and now she's ready for a new life, a new child. Just the fact is, when she gives milk to the new child, she's mesulekes domi, menika, Gemaral Masech Ketubot says, and when a woman, she breastfeeds the children, so the breastfeeding of the children cleans out the blood. Why? Because the same idea. Because breastfeeding the child is giving life, nourishing the child is giving life to the child, that able to stand on its own. The spine is giving life. So the life now came, continues to giving life to the child. That removes the blood. So it's a correlation. So really, the blood that coming out of the woman means a cleanup for new life. But when she gives birth, she doesn't have now another cycle of blood, because she's giving milk to the child, so the life is continue on. She had a new child. In the time of the Gemara, it was an obligation, even today, la halacha, that a woman should give breastfeed the child 24 months. And if a woman cannot breastfeed a child, so she should give him substance. Milk, eggs, things like that, that will sustain the child's, the protein that a child needs. There's an obligation for the mother or the father to support and bring that food to the children. It's halacha. It's halacha and not an even ezer. It's an obligation. So, it's the same idea. The idea is nida, or when a woman gives birth, it's basically the blood that comes out of her is blood that death came out, and then she's ready to start a new life. This is the beginning of Parashat Tazria. Then the tale continues on to the Parasha of Metzoyah. And what is the connection of Metzoyah, Metzoyah's leprosy? And the same idea. The Gemara says, is better for a person to throw himself to a furnace of fire than to shame his friend in public. Amal bibnei chaveru barabi, if you shame your friend in public and he turns white, it's better to jump into a furnace of fire to do that. And Toisa says that really the three things a person has to give his life for, and this is another thing a person has to give life for. Allah, a person has to give his life not to shame his friend in public. So Lashon Hara is the same idea. It's shaming somebody else, shaming when he knows about it, doesn't know about it, putting people down. Lashon Hara. So Lashon Hara is a way, a kind of a death. You're killing life. Life's excitement, feeling good, growing, connecting. And Lashon Hara is in opposition to life. Lashon Hara breaks people down. Lashon Hara separates between a husband and wife. Lashon Hara separates between friends and families. And Lashon Hara, you can very hard to fix. After you speak Lashon Hara about a person, it's very hard to fix it. Because Lashon Hara just spreads. And people love the gossip. It just spreads very quickly everywhere. So to repair Lashon Hara is very hard. There's a famous story that one rabbi, they spoke Lashon Hara against him in his community. He had to leave the community. And the people that spoke against him realized that they damaged the rabbi so much, and he had to leave the community. They came and asked forgiveness from the rabbi. And the rabbi told him, okay, I forgive you, but before, I just want to give you one thing. Here's a pillow of feathers, and I want you to go out of the city, go on a small hill out of the city, and rip open the pillow of feathers, and collect it and bring it back to me. Obviously, they went out. They ripped the pillow and they weren't able to collect the feather because it flew right away. Came back to the rise and he gave us mission impossible. So the rabbi told them, it's not an impossible mission to fulfill. Work hard, maybe you know, even if you work hard. It's the same thing as Lashon Hara. Speaking Lashon Hara, it spreads. You can never really bring, you can never repair. Okay, yes, forgiveness of the person. Can you repair the mindset, what people think, the damage that takes years and years and years, tens of years, lifetime to repair? One word just goes on and on. It's very hard to repair, almost impossible to repair. So it really correlates with the tumor, impurity is death. Lashon Hara, you can kill with your mouth. A person can kill with his anger, with his words, or with his nose, even clicking, moving the nose, blinking of an eye, a person can kill another person's, a person's life. So then what? The Torah says, "Badad yeshev michutz la'machane yemoshavu." The person that speaks lashon hara, he has to sit badad. You know what the word badad means? What? Isolation. Badad means isolation. The Talmud Ukulus translate badad means bilchudoy alone. But I heard from my brother, Rabbi Sroel, yesterday, he brought down Talmud Yonosu bin Uzil, I didn't see it inside. But he says, without a wife. Beloit is without a wife. And Rashi brings down the Gemara and Psochi. This guy that separates between people, and he separates between a husband and wife. This man that through his words he made a separation of people. He should be sitting separated outside of three camps all alone. And anyone that comes close to him, he has to say, no, no, I'm impure, get away, I cannot be next to you. I have to sit alone. And even without his wife, according to Tazria's museum, Beloita said, without a wife. I didn't see inside, but that's what he mentioned. Without a wife. So it makes even more sense. It's just a measure for measure. He's separating husband and wife. He's separating between relational people. So now he says, you have it?
Bilchudo
yotu sit alone. And to the side of his wife, he should not come close. He's separated from his wife. You know, I can imagine, you know, in America and many other countries, when they want to, in jails, there's levels. There's a jail where you can sleep with a few guys in a room. But there is the highest level of a jail is what? Isolation. They isolate a person.
Solitary confinement.
What?
Solitary confinement.
Solitary confinement. I said it correctly?
Exactly.
The idea is a person is all alone. He's a human being that doesn't connect to people. It's death. It's really dead. So the most, the biggest punishment that you can give human being is to isolate. And imagine a person is a metzora, he has leprosy, he has to sit totally alone, not his wife, his kids, family, friends, nothing. Everybody comes close to him, says, get away. Even they can't even give him, bring him food. They have to put him in a certain place, they have to leave, and he has to come and take the food. They can't come close to him. Just to be sit all alone. It's like he has a disease. Nobody can come close. People put people with disease in the isolated rooms. So why such a severe punishment? The answer is very simple. Because the person we spoke, delagatory, lashon hara, in his bad words, he separated relation of people, he isolated people from other people, husband and wife, boy, boyfriend, girlfriends, friends, people, families, through his words, through his mouth. See, he has, in order to do tshuva, to repent, he has to be in a position that he's totally isolated. Totally alone. And then he can, when he sits all alone, he can understand what he did to others.
I know that. I know.
And even then, he can never really repair lashon hara, as we said. It's like the story with this pillow of feathers. You can never repair. This is famous, what I just said now. Everybody knows. I want to add one point. 2 points, actually. When the metzora does get healed, and he goes to the temple and he brings his sacrifice. So what is the process? What do we do for that person? So it says like this. He brings two doves. Shnei torim, shnei tziporim, two birds. Because birds quick and speak all the time. Like a person speaks lashon hara. One they send free. They take a tree of a cedar tree, just to show that he had gaiva, and shnitolas means a worm. Ve'ezov is like a branch of the things that grows out of the walls. You can see all around Mount Zion those little things that grow out of the walls. Ezov means the leftover, the neglecting thing. So from the cedar tree, the tall big tree. He was like nothing. And they slaughtered one bird. They slaughtered one bird. And they take a vessel with live water out of a spring. Life. Mayim Chayim. And what do? They dip the live bird with the blood that they slaughter onto the water, this vessel with water, and they sprinkle seven times on the person that spoke lashon hara, and they send away the bird to the field, and the person has to clean his clothes, and he has to shave everything he has. Vigilachet kol saro, and we know, by the way, that Ramo brings down when we convert someone. They take him to the mikveh, three talmid chachom, the Ramo says that he should shave totally, even his eyebrows, eyebrows, everything he should shave. Shave his whole body. Like tzaraat, like a metzora. Because the hair of a person is like judgment, dinim, according to Kabbalah. So everything should be taken away. Totally shaved. Clean shave, real clean shave. Totally. Clean shave, nothing. There's nothing left. Nothing. And he goes to the mikveh and he sits 7 days. And the 7 days he shaves the hair that grew again. Everything. His eyebrows, his beard, everything he got. And he goes to the mikveh again. And the 8th day he brings 2 animals. He brings them. And then what? It's korban oilo, korban chatos. And they take from the blood and they put it on his ears. The right ear, the right thumb of his hand, and the right thumb, I don't know what the
big
blood.
Toe.
Big toe
of his right ear. What is that? What is this thing of right? What's going on? After the whole process, okay, it was all along. isolated, depressed. Nobody can come close to him. Then he does, okay, he's now the Kohen Sorim, and he has to listen to the rabbis, Talmid Chachomim, the Kohen has to say Tahor, depending on the rabbis. Now he's all pure, and he's bringing his sacrifices. So he takes two birds to say that he spoke too much. When he sends his words now, his words are going to be spread around the world. Good words, the light, the pure birds, and they leave, and he's going to learn how to speak properly. And then, yes, remember he had Kaiva, why he spoke Lashon Hara. The reason why he spoke Lashon Hara is what? Why people speak about others, they feel good about themselves, or they want to feel good about themselves. How they feel good about themselves, they're putting somebody else down. So the key, the root of speaking Lashon Hara about others is Kaiva, or a person wants to feel good about himself. So he has to remember, no, don't be that. Be shuffle, be like a worm. Okay. But now he's finally, he's waiting another 7 days, and he's now pure. Why they put this blood on his ears, and on the stump of his hands, and on the big toe of his right leg? What is this?
It's not the first time that this was done.
What?
It's not the first time.
Where are we doing
those things?
Okay, but why here?
Here.
Why here?
I haven't answered
this. There is a Gemara in Masechet Kiddushin that speaks about a slave. When a slave works for his master and he wants to extend his time more than 7 years, a Jewish slave. So they take him, they put him next to a mezuzah, next to the door, and they make a hole in his right ear in the same place, in the tnuch. And Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai asked why. Why they make a hole in the tnuch of the ozen, they pierce his ear, his ears. Why they do that for a slave? So, Omar Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, Oizen Sheshama Bar Sinai, ear that heard in the Mount Sinai. Kilibna Yisrael Avodim, you have to be a slave of Hashem. And he went and he bought a master for himself, and he's a slave to slave. His ears should be pierced. Which means, why he's being pierced in his ears and at Nuch? Because he should have listened to Hashem speaks. The Gemara in Masechet Bava Batra says, why Hashem built our ears in the shape that we have a lower part, which is very soft? Why Hashem built this little thing? So one is to capture the voice. Okay, but why is soft? Most is because earplugs, right? You can close your ears. I don't know how can you pull it so much. You have to know how to pull it and close your ears. And more than that, the Gemara says that when you take a human being and you put it on fire, or you cut the shoulder and you take an animal and you put the animal on fire, what burns first? The ears. There's a language the ears are the first one to be burned from the animals. It's to teach a person that what gets burned in first in Gehenna is the ear, because that's the gates of a person who listens to Lashon Hara, or the people, or he spoke to Lashon Hara, the people who heard. So the reason why they pierced the slave's ears is that he didn't listen properly to Torah. And he wants to become a slave. Lichoiro, a slave means his entire body is slave to Hashem. So we should make him a sign that he's submitting his body to Hashem. We say, no, the ears represents that he submits his entire body to a master, not his real master, Hashem. So he pierces his ears. Now, what's worse? A person puts himself as a slave, or a person speaks Lashon Hara? Person speaks Lashon Hara is much worse. It says it's better if a person should jump into a furnace of fire and not to shame his friend in public. Lashon Hara, all the big destruction we went out to Mitzrayim because of Lashon Hara. Atoyodati Moshe Rabbeinu says, now I know, you know why we went to Galus Mitzrayim? Because when he killed the Mitzri and the Tan of Iran told him, you want to kill us, you killed the Mitzri again, so we just spoke Lashon Hara. He says, oh, now I know why the Jewish people are in exile. The reason why we went, true, because Brisbane of Asorim, But why the Jewish people at the moment, at that time, they had the punishment because they spoke Lashon Hara? And why was the destruction of the first temple? Because the Meragim spoke in Tisha B'Av Lashon Hara in Eretz Yisrael. So everything, is because Lashon Hara. Silaschino was the second temple. So Lashon Hara. Lashon Hara is the biggest destruction. So Lichor is the worst thing. So a person should have the worst punishment, not pierce his ears, pierce both of his ears. His head has to be pierced. Who does what? The answer is yes. The person that spoke Lashon Hara, his entire body was in shock. He was all isolated, and he wasn't able to speak to no one. So he already passed that feeling of being alone. And he did tshuva because it was all alone. When a person is all alone, he's even scared. Imagine that. He's out of the city, he's all alone. Robbers can come and kill him. Nobody can even save him. He's all alone, totally isolated. All alone. Sometimes it can be for years and months and many years. Many years. Sometimes it can be many, many years. Many years. A person all alone is punishment, the most severe punishment. A person is isolated. So now he already did the tshuva. His whole body was isolated because he isolated the people. And now already they show him with a big cedar. He has a cedar tree and he has the worm. They show him from Gaiva, he went down and he's now waiting another 7 days. He's isolated. And now after he's been cured, and then he brought this first sacrifice. Now in the second after 7 days, they don't pierce his ears. They put a sign of blood on one ear. And his ears, his thumb, and his toes. His right ear, okay, represent the right strength. His thumb, put a sign of blood, and on his big toe and his leg. Now when you walk, what do you do with your hands? When you use your ears? It's not enough just when a slave wants to become a slave, just pierce his ears and that's it. No. This guy that spoke Lashon Hara, you really gave him the worst punishment. His whole body was isolated. And then they taught him this whole experience of life to teach him how much he has to purify something with the birds and with the earth. And then in the end of the end, they put a sign. They put a sign of blood on his ears, his thumbs, his right ears, his right thumb, and his right big toe of his leg to tell him he has to watch not to get to that level, not to listen to Lashon Hara, not to use his hands on Lashon Hara, and not to walk with his leg to the wrong people who can speak Lashon Hara or be empowered with Lashon Hara. Everything, walking, doing things, and hearing things, totally keep away from Lashon Hara. So the experience the Torah gives for tshuva, for a person to speak Lashon Hara, is way more than a person that wants to become a slave to a slave and not a slave to Hashem. The message is for us is really it's all death. Speaking Lashon Hara is death, is impurity, is killing people. The Gemara says about Rabbi Yochanan, the biggest praise when Rabbi Yochanan died, they gave a eulogy on his levaya, on his funeral. And what was the sermon the rabbi gave when Rabbi Yochanan, the biggest rabbi of Eretz Yisrael, that he wrote the Talmud Yerushalmi, is mentioned the most in Talmud Bavli. You know what they said about him? Sha'oyo mekarev es koyo. He used to bring close his relatives. It's very hard. It's easy to bring close other people from outside your family. To bring close people within your family, within your circle, is much, much harder. That was the praise of Rabbi Yochanan. We have to learn from this parasha. We have to march, especially comes out in the beginning of the year. Rosh Chodesh Nisan and Rosh Hashanah. Rosh Hashanah, beginning of the year. Rosh Chodesh and Shabbos. No Friday. Rosh Chodesh is? Shabbos. Shabbos is Rosh Chodesh. Tonight is Rosh Chodesh. Rosh Chodesh Nisan. A new year. Rosh Hashanah. Lashanim. Lashmitin. Layovlot. That's Tishrei. What is Nisan?
King, Malkuth.
Rosh Hashanah Lamlachim.
Chodeshim
for the month. It's the new Rosh Hashanah, the new year. A new year starts. So in what way are we going to renew ourselves? We want to renew ourselves with relationship. How do we relate to our friends? How do we relate to our family, to our wife and kids? How do we speak? What do we say? What do we listen in our ears? Hashem is teaching us such experience. What all this can happen to a person that speaks Lashon Hara. Today, we don't have Beis HaMikdash. So we don't have all the process of Lashon Hara. We don't have the punishment of leprosy, which was a mile to have, of leprosy that when a person speaks Lashon Hara, he right away sees something wrong. Imagine a person speaks Lashon Hara, whoa! What shame! You would ever anyone speak Lashon Hara?
No way.
No way, right away everybody sees it, big bushes. Today we don't have it. So in what way, what protection do we have that when we speak Lashon Hara, we could just go on our life, and we don't even feel that we hurt someone, we just go on and on and on. And a person can leave this world, and he even forgot that he hurt this guy, that guy, that guy. So the fact that we don't have leprosy nowadays, it's a punishment to us. And we don't have a way to arouse ourselves to remember and somebody to guide us that we speak Lashon Hara. So we're in the worst position. We're not in a better position, we're in the worst position. So really, the truth is, a person that really sees carefully, watch carefully what happens in his life, you will see if he spoke Lashon Hara. Suddenly you have pimples in your tongue, in your ears, this hurts you, or this goes down. If you look carefully, Hashem loves everyone. If you look carefully in your life, in your personal life, you can pick up, if you're very tuned, you know, tuned, you're very tuned to what's happening around your wife, your kids, your friends, yourself, your body, you're very tuned to the way Hashem is giving you your hardships, whatever happens around you, or to yourself. You see, or whatever you hear exactly things that have to do with the mouth or speaking and hearing Lashon Hara, you right away can wake up in new tshuva. Wake up in new tshuva. It's a famous story, I think of Moshe Shmuel Shapira. He used to go he never used to go to doctors, ever. One time, he went to doctors. So, his wife and his kids and his talmidim asked him, why are you going to doctors? You always said that you do tshuva. You know what you sin. Let's say your hand hurts you. So you know you did something wrong with your hands. Mitzvah, you put on feeling right. Whatever it is, the mitzvah that belongs to that limb, you did tshuva on. He says, yes, the reason I went to the doctors, because I couldn't figure out what sin did I do. So I went to the doctor to tell him what's wrong, so I know what's wrong, which limb it belongs to the sickness. And now I know if I'm going to do tshuva on. See, he didn't go to the doctor to heal. He went to the doctor to identify where is the problem in the body in order that Idan will do tshuva and connect to Hashem will fix what he does. So the fact that we don't have leprosy nowadays, we don't have the merit to have leprosy with the two ways that Hashem teaches us and the way we look carefully, very tuned to see where we get the punishments, which limbs and which body and what ways, and not only which limb, and what way, and what process, how do we got that punished? And what process, how do we got the pain? And we look at the process, and the time, and the place, and the limb, a person, if he's very tuned, he can pick up very quickly the reason why he got it. I remember for many, many years, I never looked on a mirror. And I didn't look on a mirror, how I look. It was a while. One time, I saw him look on the mirror, how I look. And a few days later, I got a bang or something in my face or something, and I had a scar. So I know very clear. I look in the mirror and I do it. Then he 30 minutes. A person can pick up very easy why, if a person really tuned, why and what way and where does he get it and how do he get it and what to pick up and to change. Hashem exactly speaks to us all the time. So you have to be tuned and listen. The time of the Gemara was real tshuva. Time of the Torah, they give real tshuva. Sit alone, be isolated, bring the korban noise, all that. We don't have that today. But we still have to pick up the punishments, the affliction, the problems that we have, the sorrows in our life to change. and really a person should not come unto punishment. You should learn the laws of Lashon Hara, and of being put in your heart to love another Jew. The reason why we speak bad, we put that bad about people, because as we said, this guy want to pick us up, and by feeling, by putting somebody down, we feel that we can pick us up. It's like a crate. I put somebody up, down, therefore I put myself up. But if you put in your heart just love and care, and love and care for everyone, you don't speak about other people. But really, this is really words. The real way to change that is one way. I just want to say this. I heard from my father's Tzal Kachal Rebbe. Said it many times, but it's very true svar. And we'll finish with this. This true svar is the fact that I made a decision not to speak about others and love others, that will never change. You still, when it comes to situation, that you can put somebody down, in order to pick yourself up, you will do it. The natural person will do it, unless you have real fear of Hashem. The way really to change that is to feel that there is a direct, complete love for Hashem for you ever. There's endless love to Hashem for you. So there's no need, there's no lack of feeling and happiness about yourself that you have to put somebody down in order to pick yourself up. If a person has the lack, so even if he has Yirah Shamayim, he's in the test, he's in the nisoyon to put somebody down to pick himself up because he has a lack. So he wants to fulfill that lack. For example, when a person is single, who doesn't have the love of a woman, she has a lack. You can see right away the person is uncertainty, he's fragile, he doesn't have, confidence of himself. A person is married, he has internal confidence of his wife, she picks him up, she builds him up. So he feels good. You can see the confidence of a person. Two different people. Married, not married, right away you can see it. Imagine you're married to God. You're married to the Torah. You really marry, you feel Hashem in your heart. And it's very serious. You really feel the love of Hashem in your heart. You feel the fulfillment of the love of Hashem in your heart. It has to be real. And you really feel it. You feel Hashem is loving you and you got, you have a great life journey. The best life journey you can give ever for yourself. There's no better life journey. He gave your wife, he gave your kids, he brought you into Yeshiva, whatever he gave you, help, whatever he gave you. And he gave you the love, and you feel through the journey of a life how much he loves you. And you can see the love. And whatever he gives you, if you don't see, you know in your being, in your bones, and your heart, and your soul, and your blood, and your cells, everything, you understand the love of Hashem. And you can see the love, the endless love that Hashem has for you, not for others, for you. So you don't have to, there's no need to put people down in order to pick yourself up. So if you don't have the need, then when you learn the laws of Lashon Hara, then if you have the fear of Hashem, then you can stop yourself, run away from it. Then it's easy to run away. So the tshuva of all this, in order to do really tshuva and uproot the problem of Lashon Hara, is to put life in a person's heart. Put life. How do you put life? You put Hashem into your heart. Put Hashem into your being. You have to feel that your life comes from Hashem. You have a full love of Hashem into your heart all the time. If you have that feeling, you have that understanding, you don't have to come on to Lashon Hara. That's the bypass. That's the best way to get around. Then, if you have to learn halachas, well, you're not just to feel good and feel good about yourself. So, okay, you don't need to talk about it. It doesn't mean you know what to do or what to say. You have to learn the halachot, to learn the laws. And then what's right, what's wrong, and what's the measurement, when you're allowed, when you're not, when it's a mitzvah to speak Lashon Hara, when it's not a mitzvah, and it's not Yeshus. But that's the beginning and end point, is to build a relationship with Hashem. And Chaz V'Sholem, a person did, he has to look on the punishment, the way he gets it, and the way and how and what limbs, in order to do tshuva. Should be zoiche, not to pick up from the punishment, to do tshuva and understand what Hashem is teaching us, is not even to get to that situation and build my relationship with Hashem and not to speak tshuva.